Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in amma ba'd. Inshallah, we're moving on with the next sahabi in our series of the Ashara Mubashara. And today, inshallah, we will do the life and times and the ahadith of AbdurRahman Ibn Awf, of AbdurRahman Ibn Awf. And as usual, we always begin with all of the sahaba by explaining their background and their tribe and their upbringing and their conversion, and then some of the main incidents that took place in their lifetimes. AbdurRahman Ibn Awf, he is from the tribe of the Banu-Zuhra. And the Banu-Zuhra, is the same tribe as Amina Bint-Wahab. And so AbdurRahman is a distant cousin of Amina Bint-Wahab. And the tribe of the Banu-Zuhra connects with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam from Kilab ibn Murra, who is the fifth ancestor of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Kilab had a number of sons. One of them was Zuhra. And the other one is basically Abd Manaf ibn Qusay ibn Kilab. So Abd Manaf is the grandson of Kilab. So Zuhra is one of the children of Kilab, and the Banu Zuhra therefore are the tribe that AbdurRahman ibn Awf comes from. From the same tribe is Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. So we have three famous Sahaba you should know from the tribe of the Banu Zuhra. Amina, Amina is not a Sahabiya, but the mother of the Prophet. Amina and Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas and AbdurRahman ibn Awf, they are all from the tribe of the Banu Zuhra. And Amina's second cousin is the father of Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. Okay, so Waqqas and Amina are second cousins. And Awf, which is the father of AbdurRahman, Awf is a third cousin of Amina. Okay? So Amina, the Prophet's mother, is second cousin to Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas' father, that's Abu Waqqas, and third cousin to AbdurRahman ibn Awf. Clear? I don't have a chart, but you get the point here. Essentially, all three of them, so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from his mother's side, is a fourth cousin of AbdurRahman ibn Awf. Okay, from his mother's side, is a fourth cousin of AbdurRahman ibn Awf. And as we know, all of the ten Ashara Mubashara are from the Quraysh. And AbdurRahman ibn Awf is essentially one of the middle of the Quraysh in terms of nasab, closeness to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. AbdurRahman, his name was not AbdurRahman, his name was actually Abd al-Ka'bah, or according to Ibn Sa'd, Abd al-Amr, and Abdu Amrin. And when he accepted Islam, the Prophet ﷺ said, from now on you shall be AbdurRahman. So AbdurRahman is the prophetic name given to him. So the Prophet ﷺ changed his name, as we know in the seerah, you're supposed to change any evil name, and any name that is Abd of other than Allah must be changed when you convert to Islam. So Abd Ka'bah or Abd Amr has to be changed, and so the Prophet ﷺ called him AbdurRahman. AbdurRahman ibn Awf is described as fairly light-skinned, as being tall with a slender neck and long eyelashes. He also had a lot of hair on his head, and he would, which is the style of the Arabs, tie it in a knot. That was the style of many of the Arabs at the time, that they would have a masculine knot. They had two different types of knots. Women had their types of knots, men had their types of smaller knots. And you know, still to this day, it is common in some cultures, and it's coming now a fad in this culture as well. But in the time of the Arabs, they had that thing that was acceptable to men. And AbdurRahman was known to basically have that at the back of his head as well. We had already mentioned in the last few classes that AbdurRahman ibn Awf is one of the five people who converted at the hands of Abu Bakr As-Siddiq. So, five of the ten of the Ashara Mubashara converted at the hands of Abu Bakr As-Siddiq. Okay? Five of the Ashara Mubashara converted at the hands of Abu Bakr As-Siddiq. And these are Zubair, Uthman, Talha, Sa'd, and AbdurRahman. Okay? Zubair, we talked about Zubair ibn Awam. Uthman, we already mentioned Uthman ibn Affan. Talha, we have done Talha. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas, which will be next week inshallah. And our character today, our sahabi today, AbdurRahman ibn Awf. These five converted at the hands of Abu Bakr As-Siddiq. Ibn Hajar mentions one of the reasons of his conversion, that AbdurRahman ibn Awf was a tajir, a trader, and he would travel to Yemen regularly, and he would be hosted by one of the elders of a tribe of Yemen. And it is mentioned that the year that the Prophet began preaching, his host, who was a very old man, asked him about Makkah and told him that Allah will send a prophet to Makkah in his own tribe, and this prophet will have a revelation from Allah, and this prophet will preach against idolatry. And so when AbdurRahman returned back from this trip, he met Abu Bakr As-Siddiq. Abu Bakr told him that the Prophet has been sent, so he immediately converted. So AbdurRahman ibn Awf had one of those prophecies told to him, and this is a common motif amongst many of the Sahaba, that Allah had blessed and willed for them to embrace Islam. So Allah intended for these people to meet some of the ruhban, some of the monks, some of the... So this was, in all likelihood, the books do not mention, but in Yemen, Yemen was predominantly what? Christian. So in all likelihood, this is one of the monks, one of the, or at least one of the learned of their scripture. And so he tells AbdurRahman ibn Awf that it's about time, any time now, the predicted one, the promised one is going to come. So when he hears this, then he goes back, and then he is told point blank that, oh, the Prophet has begun preaching, and he is preaching La ilaha illallah, he's preaching against the idols. So already he is awaiting this, so he immediately converts at the hands of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And of course, at this point in time, there is no Dar al-Arqam. So he is one of the early converts. As we all know, we already mentioned this, all of the 10, they are from the first batch of converts. Even before there was a Dar al-Arqam, AbdurRahman ibn Awf has already converted. And AbdurRahman, we don't know that much about him from the early Makkah Seerah. As far as I know, there doesn't seem to be anything that has been recorded in the early Meccan Seerah. What we do know is that he migrated to both of the Hijras. So he migrated to Habasha, and the first batch, he came back and he did not go again to Habasha. Okay, so we said there were two migrations to Habasha. He came back, he remained, and then he went to Medina. So he is one of the elite of the Sahaba who has migrated Sahibul Hijratain, both of the Hijras, and this is a very blessed status amongst some of the Sahaba. Very few of the Sahaba had both Hijras, and those that had are considered to be a higher level. And AbdurRahman ibn Awf is one of those who has done both of the Hijras. One of the Tabi'un, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, one of the greatest of the Tabi'un, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, he said, Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali and Talha and Zubayr and Sa'd and AbdurRahman ibn Awf and Sa'id ibn Zayd, basically the Ashara Mubashara, he said, these people would be immediately in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam during the times of battle and immediately behind him during times of salah. So it's a beautiful metaphor which is valid, that in times of battle, the Ashara Mubashara were right in front of the Prophet ﷺ. And in times of salah, they were right behind him. And this is the status of AbdurRahman ibn Awf. Now, the first major story that we are aware of, that everybody has heard of when it comes to AbdurRahman ibn Awf, is the famous story of what happened to him after the Hijrah, where AbdurRahman ibn Awf brought only a small amount of his wealth that he could carry with him. As you know, most of the Muhajirun had to leave their wealth in Mecca. Remember, there are no bank transfers. Remember, they had to flee for their lives. They can only carry the necessities of food and water and drink and whatever they can carry with them to Medina. So he arrives in Medina, and he was from a relatively wealthy background, and he comes to Medina impoverished, is somewhat of a low status now. And when he comes to Medina, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam pairs him with Sa'd ibn al-Rabi'. Sa'd ibn al-Rabi'. And this is now one of the famous stories that we've all heard growing up, and it is something that becomes the metaphor or the symbol of the generosity of the Ansar. That Sa'd ibn al-Rabi' said that, oh my dear brother in Islam, Allah has blessed me to be one of the wealthiest people of Medina. And you see my wealth, and you see I have a house of two stories, and I have two families or two wives as well. So our Prophet ﷺ has commanded us to be generous. I'm going to split everything in half with you. Take half of my wealth, choose one of the stories of the house, and choose one of my wives. After the divorce in Iddah, she will be yours. So AbdurRahman said, Barakallahu fika wa fi malika wa fi ahlik. Made dua for him. May Allah give you much more. I don't want any of this. دلني على السوق. Show me where is the souq. Where is the souq? Where is the marketplace? And this was the souq of the Banu Qurayza, right? The Banu Qurayza had a souq, which was the famous souq of Medina. They had that famous souq that is, if you're facing the Qibla, it's on the right-hand side of the masjid. If you're facing the Qibla, if you walk on the right-hand side for 5 minutes, there's still an empty place, which still to this day, there's a type of souq over there. So he said, where is the souq? So he went, and whatever he had, he brought, he sold, he purchased, whatnot. And by the end of the day, he comes back, and he has some butter and some barley. And this is how they would make their staple food item. Okay, they would mix this two together and this would be their food. So whatever he sells, he manages to get his food and a little bit surplus. The next day he comes. And then one day the Prophet ﷺ sees him and he sees the spots of perfume on his body. And he says to him, Mahyam. Mahyam is a colloquial Arabic phrase. It's not the, it's something that will translate as what's up? What's new? Mahyam, what's up? What happened? Now, why did he ask this question? Because this is an interesting cultural paradigm, and it's something that's very strange for us, but it was the norm for the Arabs of that time. The Arabs of that time, because perfume was so expensive and so difficult, they wanted to show that they had put perfume on. Putting on perfume was not just for the smell. It was also now decoration on the clothing. You would leave stains on the cloth, and that would be decoration for the cloth. In our culture, to have stains of perfume on the cloth means you messed up. And in our culture, the perfume is supposed to be invisible. And that's why it's ethanol. That's why the perfume is mixed in ethanol, because they want the ethanol to transfer the perfume from the bottle to your clothes and evaporate. Perfume is supposed to be, it's supposed to be something that cannot be seen and only smelt. But in those days, the perfume was supposed to be smelt for a short period of time, that it'll go away. And then the clothing, and I'm sure, even though it's not explicitly mentioned, but it is understood, and this is my theory and analysis, that even when they applied it, they would apply it in a certain manner. It's not just daubs here and there. It's rather a certain decoration they would put it, however they would do it, so that the cloth itself is shown to be now perfumed. So because perfume is rare and expensive, you don't wear perfume for no reason. You wear it for an occasion. And he's coming to the masjid on an average day, and he's perfumed. He has these streaks on him. So that's why the Prophet is saying, Mahyam, what's up? What's the occasion, right? Why? So imagine if somebody came, on a regular day dressed in a tuxedo, dressed in something. Even we're going to say, what's up? This is not the regular dress. So he's dressed up in the manner of perfume, right? So then he said, Ya Rasulullah, tazawajtu mra'atan min al-ansar. I got married. So subhanAllah, he comes with nothing, right? He comes with whatever is in his pockets. That's all he has. Slowly but surely, buying, selling, buying, selling, buying, selling. Now, mashallah, tabarakallah, he has a wife from the Ansar. So the Prophet said, what did you give as mahr? Like, where'd you get the money from? What's the mahr? So he said, I gave her a date seed's weight of gold. And that's actually not that much, by the way. It's just a small, an ounce or a gram or whatever you want to say. Just a bit of gold. I gave her a little bit of gold. It's not small, but at the same time, it's something. It's something. I gave her gold. That small amount, and that was my mahar. And the Prophet ﷺ then said to him, أَوْلِمْ وَلَوْ بِشَاهُ. Do a walima. Do a walima, even if it's just with the sheep, with one animal, just do a walima, so that there's a feast and a festival, because as we all know, it is sunnah to advertise the zawaj, and you should have a walima. So this is the famous hadith of AbdurRahman Ibn Awf that everybody has heard, أَوْلِمْ وَلَوْ بِشَاهُ. Then the walima becomes sunnah because of AbdurRahman Ibn Awf's marriage, because AbdurRahman got married, and this is in the first year of the hijrah. That is the hadith that because of it, all of us do a walima. All of us have that ceremony and festival because of this hadith to AbdurRahman Ibn Awf. And he continued to buy and sell and buy and sell until subhanAllah, he became one of the richest, if not the richest Sahabi. One of the richest, if not the richest Sahabi, became AbdurRahman Ibn Awf. And he says of himself that there was a time in my life when if I were to lift up a rock, I would have assumed that I would find gold and silver underneath it. Like whatever he does, his money is coming in. And of course, this is happening to him after he puts in so many years for the sake of Allah, then Allah blesses him, right? After he suffers and sacrifices, then Allah opens up the door. And the fact of the matter is, most of the Ashara Mubashara were relatively wealthy towards the end of their lives. Most of them were relatively wealthy, even though some of them were not wealthy, like Abu Bakr did not have that type of wealth. But most of them were relatively wealthy, and that we can say that they all started very difficult lives, but by the end of their lives, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened his barakat and blessings, and thatika fadlullah, that Allah blessed them in this dunya before the akhirah. But none of them lived like a wealthy person, even though they had that wealth. And AbdurRahman ibn Awf is no exception in this regard. AbdurRahman participated in the Battle of Badr, and there's a famous incident about him that inshallah we'll mention from the Musnad over here when we get to the Hadith, and all of you know it, but it is something that worthwhile to go over again. He is also in the Battle of Uhud, and the Battle of Uhud, he was of those who was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and stayed with him. He was of the people who was severely injured, where he was of the people whom a javelin or an arrow came in and knocked off his teeth. And this is AbdurRahman ibn Awf, who basically had to pull that off with his teeth as well. As well, AbdurRahman ibn Awf was injured with more than 20 wounds, more than 20 spears and arrows and basically sword injuries affected him. So much so that he forever limped after the Battle of Uhud because of an injury to his foot on the Battle of Uhud. So the Battle of Uhud caused Talha to become paralyzed and AbdurRahman ibn Awf to become limp. Okay? The Battle of Uhud that was so severe that Talha radiallahu anh could not lift up his right hand anymore. It was paralyzed. And AbdurRahman ibn Awf, he could not walk normally, and he would limp for the rest of his life. One of the main things that is mentioned, of course, he participated in every battle, in every single battle, without exception. He is there, just like essentially all or most of the Ashara Mubashara. In the fifth year of the Hijrah, the Prophet ﷺ made him a commander, a military commander, to the tribe or the area of Dawmat al-Jandal. And Ibn Sa'd mentions that when AbdurRahman ibn Awf went with around 300 people to attack this tribe, the Prophet ﷺ bid him farewell. AbdurRahman had a yellow turban on, and Ibn Sa'd mentions this, Ibn Sa'd in his Tabaqat, which is one of the earliest books of our history. He mentions that the Prophet ﷺ took off the yellow turban with his own hands and gifted him a black turban, and he wrapped it around himself of the head of AbdurRahman ibn Awf, and then he gave him advice to be sincere to Allah and to praise Allah continuously so that he could win. And he gave him a series of advice to essentially basically always be conscious of Allah Azza wa Jal. And then he said to him that if Allah Azza wa Jal blesses you with victory, then marry the daughter of their chieftain. This is what he says to AbdurRahman ibn Awf. And subhanAllah, AbdurRahman went to the tribe. He surrounded them for 3 days, and he kept on giving them yani da'wah, you know, the three choices that are given, until eventually the chieftain converted to Islam. And then AbdurRahman proposed for his daughter, and so he comes back not only a victor, but having married the daughter of the chieftain of the tribe. And from this union, the daughter of the chieftain and AbdurRahman, one of the most famous tabi'un was born. Now, you would not most likely have heard of this tabi'i. This tabi'i is well known to every student of hadith and student of knowledge, because he is famous for knowledge, for ilm, for riwayah of hadith, for fiqh, for being one of the judges of Medina. You should know, just a little bit advanced knowledge here, but still it's beneficial. You should know that in the time of the tabi'un, you know, the students of the Sahaba, there's a famous group that are called the seven scholars of Medina. Fuqaha al-Sab'ah, the seven scholars of Medina. Now this is the generation way before Imam Malik. This is Imam Malik is in the third, fourth generation. We're talking about the first 100 years of the Hijrah, right? This is essentially from 30 Hijrah to around 80-90 Hijrah. This is the first generation after the Sahaba, right? And they are called Al-Fuqaha Al-Sab'ah, the seven famous scholars. Now I'm not going to go into all of these, and that's every student of hadith and fiqh knows these names because these are famous people, but those that are outside those realms don't know them. Just what's interesting for us is that many of them, not all, many of them were sons of the Ashara Mubashara, right? These seven, right? Many of them were sons and grandsons of Ashara Mubashara, right? And just FYI, because this is interesting stuff. So, from the family of Abu Bakr As-Siddiq, it was Abu Bakr's grandson who becomes one of the Fuqaha As-Sab'ah, Al-Qasim ibn Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr. And Muhammad was also a Sahabi, Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr. Al-Qasim ibn Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr. Okay, that is one of the Fuqaha As-Sab'ah. From the family of Umar ibn Khattab, it is also his grandson, Salim ibn Abdullah ibn Umar. Abdullah ibn Umar is a famous Sahabi. Abdullah ibn Umar is the famous Abdullah ibn Umar. His son Salim becomes one of the Fuqaha As-Sab'ah. From the family of Uthman ibn Affan, it is his own son. And his son, we mention him the very first lecture of the seerah that I ever gave 5 years ago, something like that, right? Because his son, Uthman ibn Affan's son, was the first person to ever begin to compile the seerah. And he was a scholar of hadith. And he was a scholar of fiqh. And he was a judge of Medina. And that is Aban. Aban ibn Uthman ibn Affan. Aban ibn Uthman ibn Affan. Aban ibn Uthman, we are more interested in him in our classes because the first person to ever write a book on the life of the Prophet ﷺ and to compile a chronology is Aban ibn Uthman. And he's a tabi'i. He never met the Prophet ﷺ. He's a tabi'i. And he was the first to do that. So we have now Al-Qasim ibn Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, we have Salim ibn Abdullah ibn Umar, we have Aban ibn Uthman. From the children of Ali radiallahu anhu, everybody is a scholar aslan, and everybody is a great person aslan, Zain al-Abidin and whatnot. They're not considered the Fuqaha As-Sab'ah. They are a separate category altogether. They are all of them righteous and narrators of hadith, and of course the greatest of them, go fast forward three generation, Ja'far al-Sadiq was one of the Fuqaha of his era. And Abu Hanifa was a contemporary and a student of Ja'far al-Sadiq. And Ja'far al-Sadiq is no doubt a faqih and a muhaddith and a great alim. And many of the ulama studied under him. And Imam al-Bukhari's teacher is a student of Ja'far al-Sadiq. So Ja'far al-Sadiq is, the whole line of the Prophet's family, there's no need to even mention. It is understood that they are people of knowledge and taqwa. And then we have also from the Fuqaha al-Sab'ah, the child of Zubayr ibn Awam, Zubayr, and that is Urwa ibn Zubayr ibn Awam. Okay, we mention Urwa, the nephew of Aisha. We mention Urwa, the main chain of Aisha goes to Urwa. Urwa ibn Zubayr, and we talked about Urwa last week or 2 weeks ago when we did Zubayr ibn Awam. Urwa is one of the Fuqaha al-Sab'ah, and now over here we have the last of them for our purposes, Abu Salama ibn AbdurRahman ibn Awf. Our guy, AbdurRahman ibn Awf, he had many children. One of them, Abu Salama, becomes one of the Fuqaha al-Sab'ah. And there are others as well, by the way. Obviously, I only mentioned now six here. There are others as well. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib is probably the most famous of them, of the Fuqaha al-Sab'ah. And Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib was actually not, his father was not a famous Sahabi. He basically becomes one of the most famous scholars, even though his father maybe even wasn't a Sahabi, or if he was, he was a very minor Sahabi. And Sa'id ibn Musayyib, because he dedicates his life to Islam, he becomes one of the most important members of knowledge of the Fuqaha al-Sab'ah. In any case, for our purposes, back to our story, that AbdurRahman ibn Awf's son, Abu Salama, Abu Salama ibn AbdurRahman ibn Awf, he is from this union that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told AbdurRahman that if Allah gives you victory, then propose to his daughter and marry his daughter. And that's what happens. So from that union, what's going to happen when the Prophet himself is giving barakah? So from that union, one of the greatest scholars, and this person, Abu Salama, he actually becomes one of the judges in the time of the Umayyads. So he is a qadi, he is a judge in Medina. What a prestigious position amongst the sons of the Sahaba. He is one of the qadis of Medina, and this is the son of AbdurRahman ibn Awf. AbdurRahman ibn Awf, as we said, he participated in each and every battle, and we know that he participated even in the conquest of Mecca and the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, and so his name is in the list of all of the battles. I did not find anything specific about these battles that we can mention here. His participation is enough of a blessing for him. In the time of Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman radiallahu anhum, he is a primary advisor to all of these Sahaba, and a number of things are mentioned in that era that is of benefit to us. Of them is in the 18th year of the Hijrah, 18 AH, there was a plague in Syria, and this is known as the Ta'un of Amwas, the plague of Amwas. It's a very famous plague. And Umar ibn al-Khattab gave the khutbah that I'm intending to go to Syria and I don't care if there's a plague. Allah will protect us. I'm going to go. AbdurRahman ibn Awf heard this and he said, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say, if you hear of a plague in a land, then do not go there if you are not there. But if you are there, do not flee and leave. And I don't need to explain to you how prophetic this advice is. Only a prophet can make such a scientifically accurate statement 1,400 years ago. I don't need to explain to you, right? A plague. Don't run away from the plague if it's in your village. But if it's another village, don't go to that village. This is something that can only come from the words of inspiration. You cannot say something like this 14 centuries ago from your own human mind. So AbdurRahman ibn Awf says, I heard the Prophet say this. Umar, don't go. So Umar decides, okay, if you heard him say this, I'm not going to go then. Because before this, Umar was saying, Allah is going to protect. But the Prophet said, essentially, tie your camel. Then put your trust in Allah. And when it comes to plagues, the tying of the camel is, you don't walk to a plague. You don't walk into a plague. You don't go where there's a disease. Okay? The Zika virus. Don't go where the Zika virus right now. Okay? The whatever, bird flu, if it's going on somewhere, don't go there, you know, for any type of thing going on. If it's in your land, then don't flee from your land. So AbdurRahman ibn Awf gave this advice to Umar ibn al-Khattab and he followed it. Another instance as well where AbdurRahman's advice was followed, that the conquest of Persia took place in the time of Umar, as you know. And the Sahaba then differed. What do we do with these new conquered people called the Zoroastrians, the Majus? Because Allah allows us to take jizya from which group of people? No, not non-Muslims. Ahli Kitab. And who are Ahli Kitab? Yahud and Nasara. And if you want to add As-Sabi'un, who are a small group, right? Who are the Sabi'un? The Sabi'un are mentioned in the Quran twice. And the Sabi'un are a very, very, very small remnant of a people. They are still around to this day. There is less than 40,000 of them left right now. 40,000, that's it. Right? Some Eid gatherings in America are more than 40,000. And in all of the world, there's less than 40,000 Sabi'un left. And the Sabi'un, they claim to have a book that goes back to Sheth, the son of Adam. Way back. And they have another book, they say it goes back to Yahya, John the Baptist. And they have some interesting rituals. They do wudu before they pray. They do ghusl after hayd and after intercourse. They have certain rituals about whatnot. So you can see they are a group that have some sharia from back in the day. Right? And they claim to be from the time of Sheath, the son of Adam. Sheath ibn Adam. That's what they claim. And they have been around for the longest time. So the scholars of the Ummah have said the Sabi'un are also Ahli Kitab. But in reality, who amongst us has ever met a Sabi'i? And even the Sahaba, there's no narration of them meeting a Sabi'i. But Allah mentions them in the Quran. Now, Allah does not mention the other groups, what is to be done with them. When you meet a non-Ahli Kitab kafir, because Ahli Kitab are one category of kufr. What if you meet another category of kafir? What should you do? And the first category of kuffar that the Sahaba conquered that were not Ahli Kitab are the Majus. So Umar ibn al-Khattab brought together the Sahaba and he said, what should we do with the Majus now? I mean, there's what new Sharia, what can we do? Do we have a new set of laws, right? Do we tell them they cannot live in the Muslim land? What do we do? Here is where AbdurRahman ibn Awf once again, he stood up and he said that I testify that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took the jizya from the Majus of a small village in Yemen called Hajar. That I testify that the Prophet ﷺ agreed to take the jizya from the Majus of Hajar. So when Umar heard this, he said, okay, we will treat them like Ahli Kitab for the purposes of jizya. And we will not treat them like Ahli Kitab for the purposes of marriage and dhabiha. Okay? So this opened the door for the Zoroastrians to essentially have the same rulings as Ahli Kitab when it comes to religious freedom, when it comes to political taxes and whatnot, that they simply continue to pay the taxes of the Ahli Kitab, but they are not considered Ahli Kitab when it comes to marriage and when it comes to the eating of the meat. Now, interesting point here, bit of a tangent, but inshallah it's beneficial, that the Muslims, they had another issue when it came to the Zoroastrians. And that is, what is to be done with some of their practices that are un-Islamic? This is not with AbdurRahman ibn Awf, by the way, but it's just something that is useful for us to know. That when the Muslims conquered Persia, and they come across the Zoroastrians, now the Zoroastrians had some really bizarre religious practices. Really bizarre religious practices. And the issue came, to what level of tolerance can the Sharia accommodate their religious beliefs? Must we enforce our version of the Sharia on them, or do we let them be? And the most bizarre, and frankly, from our perspective, and it is correct, and the most disgusting thing that they did was that their noblemen, their elite families, would practice incest. Brothers and sisters would marry one another. Why was this the case? For the same reason that the ancient Egyptians did it. Which is why? Purity of blood. Purity of blood. They had the worst racism. And they felt, if you're from the royal families or the whatever, they had their category, the tabaqa. If you're from that tabaqa, we don't want to mix our blood with any of these common blood. And so the noble men and the noble families of the Zoroastrians, they had this practice of incestual marriages between brother and sister. Now, the issue came in Islamic law. What should we do? Should we say that this is their religion? And in Islam, to a great extent, we accommodate religion. To a great extent, but not to the Western First Amendment extent. There's no question about that. Our version of freedom is different than their version of freedom. In the Sharia, the Jews and Christians had the freedom to worship in their temples. They could not proselytize outside. They could not preach their faith to other Muslims. They could not convert other people. They could not blaspheme in public. And if they said something in their church that would be considered blasphemous, like they're believing in the Trinity, that's their religion. They're believing in the Trinity and they praise and they worship Jesus. From our perspective, this is shirk to worship Jesus, right? But in their church and in their rituals, they're going to be overlooked. But to go in the public and to call people and to do this, that's not going to be allowed. So Islam allows toleration to a great extent. Now the question arises, do we allow this marriage or not? And believe it or not, the madhahib of Islam disagreed amongst themselves. The Hanbali madhab and Ibn Qayyim ibn Taymiyyah are examples of this, said, no way. Once Islam rules, then we cannot allow these marriages to continue. And we have to force these marriages to be broken up, right? And the Malikis and Hanafis said, if we're going to allow them to commit kufr, why can we not allow them to commit the worst type of zina? I think about it. If we're going to allow them to commit kufr, وَلَيْسَ بَعْدَ الْكُفْرِ ذَنْبِ, there's no sin worse than kufr. And they're allowed to commit kufr in their churches. They're not coming to us to sanction the marriage, are they? They're having it in their own temples. Now all the madhahib agreed, if they come to us, we cannot consider this marriage valid. If they come to us to resolve a dispute in our Sharia court, we say this is not a valid marriage. But the question is, must we enforce a breakup in the lands of Islam? And the Hanafis and Malikis said, no, we don't have to do that. And the Hanbali said, yes, we must do that. And of course, to this day, this ikhtilaf remains. And so, I mean, an example of this, for example, and this is something that people are talking about now. How does all of this fit into our stance on same-sex marriage? In non-Muslim lands even, right? There's a question that is raising controversies and whatnot. In simple reality, the Mughals, when they were ruling India, and the practice of widows burning themselves, sati, right? The Arabs don't know what this is, huh? So in certain understandings of Hinduism, when the husband dies, the widow or the wife is pressured, or she wants to burn herself with the cremation of the husband. So they burn the bodies. The body is burnt in the Hindu tradition. And the practice of sati was that the wife should die with the husband. And so she would jump into the fire or put some type of, you know, kerosene or whatnot on herself and light clothes, her clothes on fire, so that she would be joining her husband at the time of death. Okay? This is a Hindu practice. Now, the Mughal emperors had to decide, what do we do? Because this is something that is very wrong. And this is not just some, I mean, this is your killing. But it's not necessary, you're not killing somebody else, you're actually committing suicide. And by and large, the emperors allowed it. The Islamic societies allowed it. They did not put a ban to it, even though in many cases they tried their best to stop it. In one case, they would give money to the widow. If you don't commit sati, we'll give you money. So they didn't like it, but they didn't stop it. Who stopped it? The British. When the British came in 1857 or so, after the mutiny and then the establishment of the British Raj, and so when the Mughal Emperor is kicked out and the British Raj takes over India, one of the first things that they do as ruling over India, British India, they say religious freedom has a toleration. We cannot tolerate certain things. And of them is, we will not allow a woman to commit suicide at the death of her husband. So the British banned sati. And when Gandhi took over, called for independence, and then 1947 India is established, the laws of India still ban sati to this day, but every once in a while, we hear it in the news. Every once in a while, because it's religion. It's religion. The woman feels that it's her code, it's her honor that she should do it. that she wants to go do this. So the question, of course, I mean, all of this is a tangent from AbdurRahman Ibn Awf's fatwa or his verdict here. To what level of religious freedom do we give other civilizations in ideal Islam? And then from that, the question arises, what if the situation is reversed, such as right now? And now we are being asked to tolerate other things, such as same sex. So to what level can we do that? So all of these obviously comes into play. Anyway, that was an interesting tangent. Now back to AbdurRahman ibn Awf. So AbdurRahman ibn Awf is the one who tells Umar ibn Khattab that yes, indeed, the Zoroastrian should be made Ahli Kitab as well. And from this fatwa, the Hanafis in particular, they allowed any religion to live in Darul Islam as long as they give jizya. Even Mushriks and Hindus, doesn't matter. Which is why the Mughal Empire had to be Hanafi. The Mughal Empire could not be Hanbali, because the Mughal Empire is ruling over Hindustan, right? You had to be Hanafi to rule over Hindustan. You couldn't be any other madhab, because the Hanafi is the only, but that's not why they're Hanafi. I'm just saying it's a good fact that they were Hanafi, because it's the only religion, madhab, that allows Hindus to live in Darul Islam. And as you all know, the Indian Pakistanis here, the Arabs have no clue because they have no idea of this branch of Islamic history. As you all know, Aurangzeb, what did he do? I guess you don't know. What did Aurangzeb do for the Hindus? Huh? Yeah, exactly. They're just like the Arabs. Look, he insulted you now. You're just like the Arabs now. You have no clue of Islamic history. Aurangzeb did not do Deen Ilahi, Yari. Come on, man, seriously? That's Akbar. Deen Ilahi goes back four generations. Aurangzeb reinstituted jizya. That's why the Hindus, another reason they hate him. Aurangzeb reinstituted the jizya. The only Mughal emperor that said that the Hindus have to give jizya. No other emperor did this. And as soon as he died, the next guy, what is it, Shah Jahan, whatever, he just like, khalas, forget about it. One person only. Okay, so he was the one who tried to apply Hanafi fiqh. Anyway, why am I talking about Aurangzeb? Let's get back to AbdurRahman ibn Awf. That was a complete tangent that's not related to the class today. Tayyib. So AbdurRahman ibn Awf gave the verdict that the Zoroastrians are also Ahli Kitab, and he says this is based on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, what else did AbdurRahman ibn Awf do in his lifetime? In his lifetime, AbdurRahman ibn Awf as well was placed in charge of the mothers of the believers, our mothers, performing Hajj. Remember, in the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab, the Ummahat al-Mu'mineen, they wanted to perform Hajj, and they did not have the opportunity to do so, and they kept on asking, we want to go. So in the last year of Umar ibn al-Khattab's life, he didn't know it would be his last year, but it happened to be his last year, and that is the 23rd year of the Hijrah, the mothers of the believers were given permission to go in one entourage for Hajj. Now, we all know the mothers of the believers have an extra special status. And as part of that status, they cannot be seen. Even their hijab and jilbab bodies cannot be seen. There's a layer of protection that no other woman ever has. So, who will do this protecting? So, Umar ibn Khattab chose two of the Sahaba, Uthman ibn Affan and AbdurRahman ibn Awf, to take charge of the special caravan of the mothers of the believers. And so Uthman was at the front, AbdurRahman ibn Awf was at the back, and they were a separate caravan within the caravans of Hajj. And these two would take charge of the affairs of our mothers and take care of them and make sure that they're separate. And they would in fact camp at a separate place that nobody could be around. And these two would be the ones protecting and setting up the tents and everything. So AbdurRahman ibn Awf was entrusted to take care of our mothers in the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab. And of course, his most important legacy for Islamic history was what happened at the death of Umar ibn al-Khattab. Because when the shura was assigned with the six people, it was AbdurRahman ibn Awf who led the entire committee from beginning to end. He was the one, when they first got together and everybody's quiet, AbdurRahman ibn Awf says, okay, first thing we're going to do, we're going to have this committee. Let three people in this room delegate to three others. We're going to have this. We can't have all of these people here. Okay? So any of you three who feels that a particular person represents him more, the same wavelength, then go ahead and nominate. So then we'll get rid of half of them. And so this is exactly what happened, that Talha ibn Ubaidillah chose Uthman. He said, Uthman represents me. Uthman's the same wavelength as me, and I'm fine with him. Zubayr ibn Awam said, Ali represents me. And Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas said, Abdurrahman, you represent me. So with one move, the committee is half. Then, as soon as it's halved, Abdurrahman says, and he doesn't, subhanAllah, he does not want power. Wallahi, from the beginning, look, he just wants to get rid of this responsibility from himself. He doesn't want it for himself. He never wanted it for himself. So now that it's the three of them, he then turns to Ali and Uthman and he says, if I get out of this and it's just you two, will you two agree to my arbitration? And Ali was the first to respond and he said, you are trusted in the heavens and on this earth. Yes, I agree. I trust you. The ones in the heavens, Allah and the angels, and us on earth, we trust you. No problem. And Uthman says, yes, your decision is final. So Abdurrahman ibn Auf for the next 3 days does not sleep. All he does is he speaks to each and every person of significance, starting from the Badriyun down to the Muhajir, down to the Bay'at al-Ridwan, down to the women and children. Everybody he spoke to in Medina. And he's getting from them pros and cons of what they think. And then on the last night, he first visited the house of Ali ibn Abi Talib and he spent a few hours there. Nobody knows what was said, but it is clear what did he say. He must have told him that the decision has been made and do not break away from the jama'ah, and whatever has been decided, I believe it is for the best and whatnot. He then visited Uthman ibn Affan, had a private conversation with him, and then the next morning, Abdurrahman ibn Auf said that I spoke with everybody and I realized that no one would turn away from the rule of Uthman. They will not prefer anybody over Uthman. Okay, this ummah is satisfied with Uthman ibn Affan. And Ali was the first to give him the bay'ah. Ali radiallahu anhu was the first to give him the bay'ah. So Abdurrahman ibn Auf, really, this is the highlight of his legacy for the ummah, in terms of him managing and steering the committee from beginning to end, smooth transition, no problem whatsoever, and he himself is out of the picture. And this shows that he was a person of managerial skills, if you like, who was not interested in the limelight for himself. And he chose Uthman ibn Affan, and subhanAllah, shortly after that, he passed away in the time of Uthman ibn Affan. Allah saved him. He did not live till the time of the fitna. He did not live in the time of the civil war. He did not see any of those issues. And in fact, the very first year of the Khilafah of Uthman, Uthman radiallahu anhu appointed Abdurrahman ibn Auf to be the one who is in charge of the whole Hajj. Now, this was a very honorable position. Every year, either the Khalifa himself, or if he couldn't go, he would delegate to a very respected person. So the last year of his life, Abdurrahman ibn Auf was put in charge of the Hajj. And he led the Hajj and he gave the khutbah in Arafat. And so he is essentially the one who is in charge of the Hajj. And then he passes away later on of the next year. Abdurrahman ibn Auf has many blessings about him. Of the blessings about Abdurrahman ibn Auf, and no doubt perhaps his greatest blessing, was that he was one of the only people whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed salah behind. One of the only people whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed salah behind. And this took place in the Battle of Tabuk. In the Battle of Tabuk, if you remember, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam camped at Tabuk for maybe around 30 nights. There was no actual battle. And they were waiting for the Romans, and they were waiting for the Banu Ghassan, and nobody actually showed up. They were terrified, they fled. So for 30 days, the Prophet is camped over there. And one day, Fajr Adhan is given, and the Prophet has not come back from, the wudu, not come back from taking care of himself. And time is going on, and the Sahaba are worried that the sun might rise. So they don't find the Prophet ﷺ, and they're worried that the salah will finish, and so they look around, and Bilal is the one who said, "AbdurRahman ibn Awf, will you lead the salah?" So AbdurRahman said, "Okay." So he began leading Salat al-Fajr. They went into the first rak'ah, they stood up, and the Prophet ﷺ comes back with Al-Mughira ibn Shu'bah. Al-Mughira ibn Shu'bah was the one who was carrying his water and his staff. You know, the Prophet ﷺ, there was always somebody who volunteered. There was no servant, there was somebody who volunteered. And Al-Mughira was not a slave or a servant, he's a noble Sahabi. But what better servant, you know, what better job to do than to be a servant of the Prophet ﷺ. So he volunteers to go out and take care of the Prophet ﷺ. So Mughira comes back, and when he sees AbdurRahman leading the salah, he's about to go forward to tell him, "Get back, the Prophet ﷺ is here." And the Prophet ﷺ holds on to him, and they stand at the end of the line, and it's dark, and it's cold, and everybody is covered, so nobody recognizes. Nobody recognizes. And the salah finishes, and the Prophet ﷺ stands up to pray one rak'ah. And everybody dead still. What's going to happen now? What's going to happen now? AbdurRahman does not know what to do. He's just sitting there quietly. And then the Prophet ﷺ finishes, and he sees them all waiting for him. And he goes, "Qad asabtum, you have done correct. This is exactly what needs to be done. The salah should have been started, and you did what is correct. Qad asabtum." So this is the one time that the Prophet ﷺ prayed an entire rak'ah behind somebody. Now, he did pray behind one other sahabi, and that is of course Abu Bakr As-Siddiq, we all know this. But the big question, did he pray a full rak'ah behind Abu Bakr As-Siddiq? And Allah knows best. I spent an hour doing just this research, just this. There are two times that Abu Bakr As-Siddiq kinda led the Prophet ﷺ. Let me explain. One time, early Medina, the Prophet ﷺ went to resolve a dispute from one of the tribes, and it was most likely at Asr time, where the Adhan was called and he did not come back, and they didn't know what time he would come back, and he was at a far away outer province or whatever, not province, but you know, the outskirts of Medina. And so Bilal said to Abu Bakr, "Lead the salah, the Prophet is not here." And the assumption was he would come before Maghrib. And Abu Bakr stood up in the saf and began the salah, but the Prophet came in the first rak'ah. And they began to make noises, the Sahaba. They began to make noises, and they began to whistle in the salah, and they began to clap, right? And Abu Bakr did not budge, because Abu Bakr, when he was in salah, he was in salah. But the noise level is increasing very loud, and there's whistling and clapping and loud noise. And Abu Bakr is in front. So he turns around and he sees. And there is, of course, now when the Prophet came, now it's daytime, everybody can see him. So wherever he would go, the Sahaba would let him go forward until he is standing in Saf al-Awwal. Okay, so he is standing behind Abu Bakr as-Siddiq now. So he turns around and he sees the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sees him looking at him, so makanak, it is halal and permissible to communicate to others in salah with your hands. You may communicate with your hands. That's permissible. Says makanak, stay there. Stay where you are. And Abu Bakr went up like this, that Alhamdulillah, and then Raja' al-Qahqara, he walked backwards. He walked backwards because you're not supposed to face the Qibla, a turn away from the Qibla, and he walked backwards, allowing the Prophet ﷺ to come forward, right? So the Prophet ﷺ came forward, finished the salah, and then when the salah is finished, so then he says that, "Oh Abu Bakr, why did you not listen to me when I told you to stay? Ma mana'ak? Why did you come back?" And Abu Bakr said, "Ma kana libn Abi Qahafa." It is not befitting for the son of Abu Qahafa to lead Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in salah. How can I lead him in salah? Ma kana libn Qahafa? Not me. Then he said to the people, don't make noises in salah, don't clap and whistle in salah. If you need to say something or communicate, what should the men do? Subhanallah. And he said, إِنَّمَا التَّصْفِيقُ لِلنِّسَاءِ. Let the women clap. Let the women clap and let the men say Subhanallah. This was the hadith that came that said women should clap in salah and the men should say Subhanallah. So he didn't actually pray a full rak'ah behind Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. He started the salah behind him. He became ma'moon for a while and then switch happened. Okay. In the week before the final the death of the Prophet ﷺ, there is a controversy. Did the Prophet ﷺ pray behind Abu Bakr or not? There is a controversy. And the strongest opinion seems to be that when the Prophet ﷺ came out too weak to stand up, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq prayed next to the Prophet ﷺ on his right hand side. And the Prophet ﷺ was sitting down, and Abu Bakr was following him, and the Sahaba were following Abu Bakr because they couldn't see the Prophet ﷺ sitting down. This is the strongest opinion. There is another opinion that the Prophet ﷺ sat and Abu Bakr is leading. But Ibn Hajar and others, they say it doesn't make sense. How could Abu Bakr do this when even before he didn't do that, right? And in fact, it seems to be the case, and there are versions that mention this, that they saw Abu Bakr saw the Prophet ﷺ, right? So they were following Abu Bakr, and Abu Bakr was following the Prophet ﷺ. And in fact, from this, we Sunni Muslims derive the status of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. The Ummah looks to Abu Bakr, and Abu Bakr is looking to the Prophet ﷺ. This is our understanding of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. So the strongest position, which I think is very clear when you look at the narrations, and Allah knows best, but I spent quite a while doing this today as well. Allah knows best. It doesn't appear that the Prophet ﷺ prayed behind Abu Bakr in the week that he passed away. Rather, on that one occasion when he went out very weak, he was the imam, but he couldn't stand up. So Abu Bakr became the, call it na'ib imam, call it the middle, but he's not technically the imam. Abu Bakr is not the imam. It is the Prophet ﷺ and then Abu Bakr and then the... So we can say, if this narrative is correct, that AbdurRahman ibn Awf is the only sahabi whom the Prophet ﷺ made a sajda and he was the imam. And that is a blessing. Every sahabi has certain blessings. Abu Bakr no doubt is greater than AbdurRahman ibn Awf in a million one ways. But in this one way, AbdurRahman ibn Awf has a fadila that even Abu Bakr did not appear to get. And that is that an entire rak'ah, one rak'ah, was prayed behind AbdurRahman ibn Awf. And Ibn Sa'd mentions in his tabaqat, and the chain is slightly weak, but no problem in narrating it, that the Prophet ﷺ said at this occasion, never did any Prophet die until he prayed behind a righteous man from his ummah. Never did any Prophet die unless until he prays behind one righteous man of his ummah. So this is a sunnah of Allah, that even the Prophets have to pray behind somebody of their ummah who is righteous. Now the hadith is not fully authentic, but the concept inshallah is valid. And there is no question that anybody whom the Prophet is praying behind must be a righteous person. There's no question. Logic, human nature, the Quran sunnah is pretty obvious. This must be the case. And also of the blessings of AbdurRahman ibn Awf was how the Prophet ﷺ defended him when another Sahabi criticized him. And this is actually a very controversial story in that it's easily misinterpreted, but as you know me, we will say it, and inshallah, if you speak the truth and you're clear about it, there's no room for misinterpretation. And this story occurs a few months after the conversion of Khalid ibn al-Walid. Khalid ibn al-Walid converted before the conquest of Makkah. And after the conquest of Makkah, the Prophet ﷺ sent Khalid ibn al-Walid to the tribe of the Banu Judhama. And this is where it gets awkward or whatnot, when the contingent arrives to the tribe of the Banu Judama, the tribe wanted to embrace Islam. And so it's as if they are saying that, okay, we're not going to fight. We submit. Because remember, after the conquest of Mecca, the Prophet ﷺ sent many small groups to basically see if the other tribes are going to convert or fight. So the tribe of the Banu Judama, they had their swords and they had their armor as if they're going to fight. When they saw it was Khalid ibn al-Walid, they put their swords down. And when Khalid said, why do you have your swords out? You want to fight? They said, no, we're worried for another tribe that they're having a war with. In case it was that tribe in the distance, we became armed. Now that it's you, we know what's happened, we've heard the story. And then they said, قَدْ صَبَأْنَا. Now, صَبَأَ was their way of saying أَسْلَمْنَا. It's advanced Arabic here, right? صَبَأَ was their way of saying we have accepted Islam. But it's not the standard way of saying أَسْلَمْنَا. Because the Arabs would call the religion of the Prophet ﷺ that this is قَدْ صَبَأَ, right? From the same root as صَابِئُون. The same root that he's left the way of idolatry and found the way of Ibrahim. They would call the way of Ibrahim is the way of صَبَأَ. So they said قَدْ صَبَأْنَا, قَدْ صَبَأْنَا. And Khalid did not accept this from them for whatever reason. And we excuse him for, we don't accuse him of intentionally doing this. And he commanded that they all be taken prisoner and be executed as enemies of war. And the Muhajirun and Ansar said, no, they have accepted Islam. We're not going to listen to you. So they did not listen to Khalid ibn al-Walid. But some of the new converts were more than happy because of personal grudges between the Quraysh and the Banu Judama. Okay? And so people were killed. People were killed. And when the contingent returned to the Prophet ﷺ, and the Prophet ﷺ found out what had happened, hadith is in Sahih Bukhari, he raised up his hands, he faced the Qibla, and he said, O Allah, I have nothing to do with what Khalid just did. Meaning, I did not tell him to kill those people. I have nothing to do with what Khalid just did. And he asked Khalid, why did you do what you did? And Khalid ibn Walid gave his excuse that they weren't really accepting Islam. They just wanted to protect themselves. Now, you know, in our Sharia, by the way, which Khalid clearly did not know, in our Sharia, what do we believe? If somebody accepts Islam, even at that stage, what do? Accept it. Clearly, yani Khalid is a new Muslim and he just, whatever reason, he just feels this is not going to work with me, you know. And AbdurRahman ibn Awf said to Khalid at this time that you killed them because of a personal grudge, because they killed your uncle in the days of Jahiliyyah. Now you know how the Arabs were. They would live these things on for generation. And Khalid is a new Muslim. Remember, he's a brand new Muslim, few months old now. So we forgive him for this outbreak. He turns to AbdurRahman ibn Awf and he uses some very harsh language. Some very, let's just say harsh language, leave it at that. And he says to him, and how about your own father, Awf, whom the same group, Banu Judama, killed? Now this is in the days of Jahiliyyah, going back 40 years, right? You know the Arabs, they never forgot these grudges. You know this, like the Jahili Arabs, this was all their revenge. You killed this, you killed that, you know, just like that's the way it's going to be. And so Khalid ibn Walid is saying, you owe me a favor because I killed some of the Banu Judama. Your own father was killed by this tribe. Now you have the audacity to rebuke me. Rather, you owe me a favor because I did this to them. And he used some very harsh language against AbdurRahman ibn Awf. And the Prophet ﷺ is standing there. And then the Prophet ﷺ utters one of the most famous ahadith that we've all heard, but hardly anybody knows the context. The hadith is Bukhari and Muslim. The hadith is well known, but hardly anybody knows the context. And the hadith is, لا تسبوا أصحابي. Don't curse my companions. فَوَاللَّهِ, if one of you were to give the mountain of Uhud in gold, it would not be equivalent to one hand of what they gave, or not even half of a hand of what they gave. If you give the mountain of Uhud as gold, it would not be one hand of grain, not even half of a hand of grain, for what one of my Sahaba gave. Now, this hadith, we use it all the time to talk about the status of the Sahaba, and that's true. What we don't understand, who was the hadith meant for? Another Sahabi, Khalid ibn Walid, right? So if the Prophet ﷺ is telling Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu an, that you cannot reach the level of AbdurRahman ibn Awf, and if you were to give the mountain of Uhud in gold, you would not reach the level of AbdurRahman ibn Awf, then where do I and you and all of us stand when it comes to these figures? Khalid ibn Walid, who did what he did, right? And who is the sword of Allah, and who is the conqueror of Islam. And the Prophet is telling him, you will not reach a handful of what AbdurRahman ibn Awf did. Where do we stand when it comes to Khalid, much less when it comes to AbdurRahman ibn Awf or Abu Bakr and Umar, right? So this is that famous hadith that the Prophet said, don't curse the companions. And of the blessings, so we're talking about the blessings of AbdurRahman ibn Awf, of the blessings of AbdurRahman ibn Awf, is that AbdurRahman ibn Awf is perhaps the main Sahabi who clearly is going out of his way to take care of our mothers, the mothers of the believers. And he would be very, very generous with his money to the mothers of the believers. And this is in fact mentioned in a hadith by the Prophet ﷺ, reported in the Mustadrak of Al-Hakim, that one day Umm Salama narrates that the Prophet ﷺ said to his wives, the one who shows you mercy after I die is the Sadiq and Al-Bir. He's the good and the righteous man. The one who shows you mercy after I die, the one who helps you after I die, that is the truly righteous person. And in the same hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, O Allah, bless AbdurRahman ibn Awf to drink from the salsabil of Jannah. And it was AbdurRahman ibn Awf who continuously used to send large amounts of gifts to our mothers. He would send hundreds of coins. And on his deathbed, he gave the wasiyah of 400 gold coins to each of the mothers of the believers who were still alive from his inheritance. 400 would go to each of the mother of the believers, gets 400 coins. And it is reported in Ibn Sa'd's Tabaqat that one day he gifted all of the mothers some gifts. And when Aisha received all of this, she said, who is this from? They said, from AbdurRahman ibn Awf. So she said, may Allah give him the salsabil to drink. Same hadith. So the Prophet is saying salsabil, and the mothers know that AbdurRahman ibn Awf is going to be the one who will drink from this salsabil. And despite all of this wealth, and he, as we said, is probably one of the most richest, if not the richest Sahabi of his generation. Despite all of that wealth, he himself lived a very simple life. Sahih Bukhari reports that once AbdurRahman ibn Awf was fasting and he was brought his food. And when he saw all of the types of food in front of him, and AbdurRahman had money and he had servants, and so the servants were cooking the best food for that generation. And so all of these plates are brought in front of him. He began to cry when he saw what he's about to break his fast on. He began to cry. And he said, Hamza died, radiallahu anhu, and he didn't even have enough cloth to use as his kafan. And Mus'ab died, and his qamis was his kafan. Qamis, his shirt, was his kafan. And as for me, I fear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has basically taken up my good deeds and returned them to me in this world. That all of these blessings I'm getting as a result of my good deeds, so what am I going to have in the akhirah? What will I have left in the akhirah? So he began to cry that those people, they died without any of this wealth, and I have all of this wealth. And in another incident as well, it is reported that one day dinner was brought to him, and it consisted of bread and meat. And of course, bread and meat for that era was luxury, and for us it is staple. We know this, I've said this many times. For us it is staple food item, that's the lowest. For them it was luxury food. And dinner is brought, and there's bread and there's meat. And he begins to again cry. And he says, the Prophet ﷺ died without him and his family ever eating even the coarsest bread to fill their stomach. They never even have enough bread to fill their entire stomachs. And I worry that I have been left here, and all of them have been taken away, and I have been left here to basically all of my good deeds are being returned to me. So he's worried now that he's not going to get the blessings of the Akhirah, even though he himself lived a very simple life. And it is said that his clothes and his demeanor and his appearance, you could not tell him apart from his servants. He did not, and this is the way of all of the elite of the Sahaba. Those that were blessed with wealth, such as Uthman, such as AbdurRahman ibn Awf, such as Talha and Zubayr, they had wealth. But that wealth did not occupy their hearts. And they were the most generous. And AbdurRahman is one of those that is demonstrating that generosity. And despite the fact that he indeed did have so much wealth, it was not shown on his appearance. You couldn't see him to be wealthy. Even though when he died, he owned more than 1,000 camels. 1,000 camels. Most of the people at that time did not even own a single camel. It's like in many third world countries, most people don't own a car. Imagine, that's still the case. AbdurRahman ibn Awf owned 1,000 camels and many thousands of sheep. And the list goes on and on when you read the books of Tarajum. And he left four wives, all each one of them got 80,000 dirhams. That's like a fortune. And the wives are getting 1/8. And because they're four, they're getting 1/4 of 1/8. So do the math here, right? So 1/4 of 1/8, and they're getting 80,000 dirhams. So AbdurRahman ibn Awf is leaving a fortune. And when he died, he gave the wasiyah that every Badri sahabi is going to get this many gold coins. And every mother of the believer is going to get 400 gold coins. So that is the 1/3 that he's allowed to do as he pleases with. Who does he give it to? The Badri and the mothers of the believers. This is at the time of his deathbed. And therefore, clearly, AbdurRahman ibn Awf was of the wealthiest of the Sahaba. And this is the sunnah of Allah. As you give to Allah, He gives back to you. He was a very generous man, and Allah continued to give back to him. AbdurRahman, he married frequently, as is the case amongst the Sahaba. The norm of the Sahaba is, mashallah, tabarakallah. They had. I knew exactly where the comments would come from. AbdurRahman had how many wives? You want to guess, yeah, Fulan? You want to guess? I don't want to say your name on the thing. How did you know? How did you know? I'm surprised. Oh, you read up on it? You serious? Okay, only about the marriages. He had 16 wives. 16 wives, mashallah, tabarakallah. In the course of his life, he had 16 wives. And he had more than 25 children, mashallah, tabarakallah. More than 25 children he had. And he left, as we said, a fortune for all of his wives and children. When he passed away, each one of them inherited, mashallah, massive amounts of money. And of course, his most famous son, as we said, was Abu Salama, who became one of the fuqaha as-sab'a. One of the fuqaha as-sab'a. One final point, and then just two or three hadith, then we're done for the day. Unfortunately, there is a well-known yet weak or fabricated hadith that a lot of people know about AbdurRahman ibn Awf, but it is not true. It's not authentic. And that is the hadith that the Prophet ﷺ allegedly said, قَدْ رَأَيْتُ عَبْدُرْرَحْمَنِ ibn Awf يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةَ حَبْوَى. I saw the Prophet ﷺ allegedly saying this, not an authentic hadith. I saw AbdurRahman ibn Awf entering Jannah like hobbling or crawling. He's not entering it properly. Or in another version, that he's entering Jannah so many years after the rest of the people, right? And this hadith has in it a number of people that are weak. And in fact, Ibn al-Jawzi, The famous scholar of Hadith, Ibn al-Jawzi, is a very famous Hanbali scholar at 595 Hijrah. Ibn al-Jawzi put this Hadith in his Kitab al-Mawdu'at, which is a book of fabricated Hadith. And he said this Hadith is fabricated. Even though many other scholars, they said it's not that low, but it's one level above it, which is basically munkar or rejected. Right? That somebody made a mistake. Fabricated means somebody intentionally fabricated. And one level above munkar means somebody messed up and is just not right, but it's not fabricated. And the majority position of the scholars, in fact, all of the scholars of hadith say this hadith is not authentic. And I mean, there are no need to go into all of the details of that. But suffice to say that this hadith is not authentic because the chain of narrators has some major weaknesses. And because it contradicts the simple reality that AbdurRahman ibn Awf is one of the 10 Ashara Mubashara. How can one of the Ashara Mubashara be crawling into Jannah? Does not make any sense. So unfortunately, this hadith is used by a lot of people, especially the storytellers, when they talk about AbdurRahman ibn Awf that, oh, you know, because he was rich, he was gonna, you know, no, there's no such thing. AbdurRahman ibn Awf was indeed very rich, and his riches will inshallah only help him to go higher and higher in Jannah. Very quickly, AbdurRahman ibn Awf only has around 15 hadith, very little, and he was not known to be a hadith narrator. And I just wanted to quote some hadith of AbdurRahman ibn Awf from the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, that of the hadith of AbdurRahman ibn Awf, that he said, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam say that I witnessed the Hilf al-Mutayyabin with my uncles while I was a young lad, and I would not wish that my position there be substituted even if I had a whole flock of camel, meaning I would not want to be removed from that for $1 million. I would rather be there and be a part of Hilf al-Mutayyabin. What is Hilf al-Mutayyabin? Hilf al-Fudul, Hilf al-Mutayyabin. What is Hilf al-Mutayyabin? When the Quraysh came together and they agreed that there will be justice in Mecca, that no weak person will be taken advantage of by a strong person. So this is Hilf al-Mutayyabin. Of the hadith narrated by AbdurRahman ibn Awf, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that Allah says, so this is a hadith Qudsi from AbdurRahman ibn Awf. And this is the only hadith Qudsi that is narrated from AbdurRahman ibn Awf. That the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah says, I am Ar-Rahman and I created Ar-Rahim. And Ar-Rahim means the womb, or to be metaphorically means the family. Ar-Rahim means the womb, but what is the meaning of Ar-Rahim in Arabic? It means the family. So I am Ar-Rahman and I created the family, and I created the family from my name. And this hadith is in Bukhari as well. So the hadith is authentic. So it's a muttafaq alayhi hadith, right? So I am Ar-Rahman and I created Ar-Rahim. Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. Ar-Rahim, as we said, means the womb. But when you say Ar-Rahim in Arabic, it's as if you're saying the English word, the family. So I am Ar-Rahman and I created the family, and I created family from my name. Right? The concept of family is coming from my name. So whoever is close to the family is close to me. And whoever breaks off from the family breaks off from me. Okay? So this is a beautiful hadith narrated by AbdurRahman ibn Awf. One of the tabi'un says, I met Abu Salama ibn AbdurRahman, the famous tabi'i, and I said, narrate to me something that you heard from the Prophet ﷺ, something that you heard from your father, from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, about the month of Ramadan. So Abu Salama says, I heard my father AbdurRahman say that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah has made the fasting of Siyam fard and the Qiyam sunnah, which is the Tarawih. So whoever fasts Ramadan and prays Ramadan, iman and wahtisaban, all of his sins will be forgiven, like the day his mother gave birth to him. The famous hadith, but now we have it from AbdurRahman ibn Awf. From AbdurRahman ibn Awf, who said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if a woman prays her 5 prayers, fasts her 1 month, protects her chastity, and listens to her husband, then it will be said to her, enter Jannah from whatever door that she pleases. From AbdurRahman ibn Awf, that one day the Prophet went outside the masjid and I followed him until he entered into a garden. And he fell into sajda, and he stayed there for a long time until I began to feel that perhaps he had died in sajda. Then I came close to him, and I looked. And when he saw me, he then went up from sajda. And when he finished, he said, "What is the matter with you, Ya AbdurRahman?" So I explained to him that I got worried, you're in sajda for so long. So he said to me, "Jibreel came to me and said, should I not give you glad tidings? Allah has said that whoever prays upon you, he shall pray upon him. And whoever says salam upon you, Allah will send salam upon him. Man salla alayka sallallahu alayhi wa sallam alayka sallam alayhi." Right? So the famous hadith, but now we get the beautiful story of AbdurRahman following him. And the even more beautiful story that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fell into sajda thanking Allah for such a long time when this happens. And time is up. I'll just quickly do the one hadith that I wanted to do. There's others as well, but we'll just do one more hadith. And that is from AbdurRahman ibn Awf, that he says, now this is the hadith I said that deals with Badr. And we've done the story many times, but now we find it in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad. That on the day of Badr, I stood at the battle in my line, and I looked to my right and I looked to my left, and I was disappointed to see two young lads from the Ansar. And I wished that I had been in a better company rather than these two kids. You all remember the story, right? Then all of a sudden, one of them poked me and he said, "Oh uncle, do you know who Abu Jahl is?" And I said, "Of course I do. What do you have to do with him?" So he said, "I have heard that he has cursed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I swear by the one who has my soul that my shadow will not depart from me until I either kill him or he kills me." So I said, "I'll show him to you when I see him." Before the battle could begin, the other one pokes and says the same thing. And I was amazed at this. And when I finally saw Abu Jahl, I showed them who Abu Jahl was. And he goes, and he said, "This is the man you have both been asking me about." So the both of them raced out. Fatabadara, the both of them are basically racing out. And the both of them struck him until they killed him. And then they came back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, each one saying, "I did it, I did it." And the Prophet said, "Did you wipe your swords?" They said, "No." So he said, "Show me the swords," and both of the swords had blood on them. So the Prophet said, "The both of you have killed, both of you have succeeded in killing Abu Jahl." And this is of course Mu'adh ibn Amr and Mu'adh ibn Afra, or Mu'awwidh ibn Afra, both of these names. So this is the famous hadith of AbdurRahman ibn Auf. This was AbdurRahman ibn Auf between the two lads of the Ansar. And he said, "I was happy now when I found out how eager they were." And there are other hadith, but time is over. So inshallah ta'ala, with this we have finished AbdurRahman ibn Auf. And next week inshallah we'll move on to another of the Ashara Mubashara, and that is Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas inshallah ta'ala. Bismillah. AbdurRahman ibn Auf, I forgot to mention, Jazakallah khair for reminding me. So he passed away in Medina, right, in the time of Uthman. And he was buried in Baqi' al-Gharqad. And according to the strongest opinion, he was around 74 or 75 years old. Okay, 74, 75 years old. And Uthman led the janazah. I forgot to mention this, Jazakallah khair. Uthman led the janazah. And Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas was the one holding on to the janazah, both sides with his both hands, the front side. Like, yani, as a respect, he held on to both of the sides, and then other people behind him as well. So his grave is in Baqi' al-Gharqad, because he died in Medina in the Khilafah of Uthman ibn Affan. Inshallah. Inshallah, with this we'll stop for today and then resume next week, inshallah ta'ala.